This is the BBC television service. We now present another program in our series of experimental transmissions in colour.
We live in a kaleidoscopic world. But colours are more than mere decoration. Colours carry deep and significant meanings for us all. And in this series, I want to unravel the stories of three colours. Three colours which, in the hands of artists, have stirred our emotions, changed the way we behave, and even altered the course of history. Blue. The arrival of lapis lazuli from the East made blue the colour of our dreams. A colour that's transported us to worlds beyond our horizons. White. Once the virtuous colour of ancient marbles, came to embody our darkest instincts. But in this programme, I want to tell the story of a colour we've worshipped since the very beginning. One that at first may not seem like a colour at all.
So this is the gold vault beneath the Bank of England. And in this room, there are about 65,000 bars of solid gold. And each one of them is worth almost £500,000. And I just can't resist picking one up.
Oh, the first thing you notice is the weight. It's extraordinarily heavy. And you can see on the front there, it's 99.99% pure gold. And I really don't think I've ever held anything so valuable in my hands before. But gold has another quality too. Its colour, this glorious, radiant yellowness. And I think this colour is one of the most alluring and beguiling colours of them all.
This is a tale of our timeless obsession with all things golden. Across the millennia, we have used gold to revere the things we've held most sacred. And reflected in our works of art, we see the story of ourselves and our changing beliefs and perceptions.
I'm aware that I'm praying with colour. I'm not just praying with words, but I'm praying with colour.
From honouring our ancient gods to the worldly kings and queens of the Renaissance, we'll reveal the techniques which craftsmen have used.
Look at that.
From the fine arts of icon painting to the dark arts of alchemy.
So really, this must have been a desperate time for Berger. He had to think about how to escape with his life.
We'll see how in the consumer age, gold came to represent little more than wealth itself. And we'll see how one painter attempted to restore the colour of gold to divine status. Nobody knows when humans first took gold from the earth. We can only imagine their wonder at what they saw.
This is perhaps what gold looked like when humans first set eyes on it. You can see why they fell in love with it almost immediately. Not because of its rarity, because they didn't know it was rare. And not because of its versatility, because they didn't know what it could do. They fell in love with it because of the way it looked. Its wonderful, radiant, warm yellowness. And there was really only one thing in the universe that looked anything like this substance. And that was the sun.
Ancient people came to believe that gold and the sun were one and the same. So when they honored the sun, only the color of gold would suffice. A golden sun disk, 2000 BC. A ceremonial necklace, 800 BC. And the most remarkable of all, a sun chariot from 1500 BC. Now the star exhibit at the National Museum of Denmark.
This is one of the most remarkable things I've ever seen in a museum. It's utterly breathtaking, because what we have here essentially is a 3,500-year-old miniature model chariot in virtually mint condition. So you can see there's this utterly delightful bronze horse with its ears pricked up attentively, and it's standing on these four wheels and dragging this great disc behind it. And that disc is the sun. And for the people who made this, the sun was a great golden goddess that was being carried by this divine horse every day across the sky from east to west and then back again at night. And it is believed that the elders of the community, the priests, would actually pull it around back and forth to teach people about the importance of the sun. And it's decorated with all these exquisite patterns that represent the radiating rays of the sun, that pulsating light, and its movement through the years. It's an explicit connection between the color of gold and the color of the sun. Both of them have this warm, radiant yellowness. Both of them have this terrific sparkle, and both of them have this eternal shine. Because it's 3,500 years later now, everything else has deteriorated, but the gold on this disc, like the sun outside this room, is still shining.
The desire to honor the sun with gold is as old as civilization itself. But one civilization would come to be identified with golden treasures like no other. The ancient Egyptians were unique. While many cultures had to hunt down gold in far-off lands, trade or barter for it, here in northeast Africa, the Egyptians found gold everywhere. Now, the ancient Egyptians were very, very lucky. Their territory here was blessed with seemingly unlimited reserves of gold. There were hundreds of deposits dotted all over the place. And the richest of these deposits were here in these mountains of the eastern desert, and here farther south into Sudan and Nubia. And what's more, the Egyptians were very, very good at extracting that gold. They had huge teams of men working day in, day out, bringing it out of the earth. And for that reason, Egypt quickly became the world's first great gold-producing state. But to understand the exquisite gold work in ancient Egypt, we have to leave Cairo and head south into the desert. This is Saqqara, home to some of the oldest tombs in Egypt. And here is some remarkable evidence of the reverence the Egyptians had for their goldsmiths. F- 4,000 years ago, the Grand Vizier Meruka was interred in these chambers. In life, he was entrusted with the production and protection of Egypt's gold. And carved onto the walls of his tomb are depictions of his invaluable work.
These relief carvings depict pretty much the entire Egyptian gold working process from start all the way to finish. So the first step is recorded here, and this involves the weighing of the gold. And you know, what I find interesting about that is, of course, the Egyptians had plentiful quantities of gold, and yet still it was so valuable that the pharaoh didn't want even a single little bit unaccounted for. But the two most remarkable images, I think, in this entire relief are these two here. And I think they're remarkable for two reasons. First, the hieroglyphs you can see there and there. Now, usually we presume ancient hieroglyphs to impart some solemn wisdom, but not these ones, because this man is saying to that man, "Ooh, isn't this beautiful?" And this man is saying to that guy, "Get a move on with your work, slow coach." It's just an amazing moment of humour and life and reality from thousands of years ago. But the other remarkable thing about these images here is all four goldsmiths are dwarfs. All across ancient Egypt, dwarfs are depicted as gold workers because they were actually perceived by ancient Egyptians as possessing magical powers. So it seems utterly logical that who would you get to work with your most precious and special material? You would get your most precious and special people.
For millennia, the great creations of these goldsmiths were mostly lost to view. They were melted down by grave robbers, or simply lay undiscovered deep beneath the sands. But in the 20th century, one British archaeologist was determined to bring them to light. Howard Carter was a maverick who had come to Egypt in search of gold. And it was he who made the greatest archaeological discovery of all time. On the 26th of November, 1922, Carter broke into the tomb of Tutankhamun.
A gasp of wonderment escaped our lips. So gorgeous was the sight that met our eyes. Everywhere the glint of gold.
The golden treasures of Tutankhamun were never intended to be seen by human eyes. But Carter removed them from their resting place and bundled them off to the Egyptian Museum in Cairo. The hoard contained Tutankhamun's throne, jewelry of every sort, golden slippers, and this huge sarcophagus. It contains 110 kilograms of solid gold and is the largest gold object ever found in Egypt. But the most astounding treasure made by the ancient Egyptians is this.
The death mask of Tutankhamun. And you know, it's in solid gold, of course, 11 kilograms of it. And this mask would have sat right on top of the dead pharaoh's face.
The craftsmanship is exquisite. The gold is inlaid with precious stones, with lapis, feldspar, and carnelian. And the eyes modelled with obsidian and quartz.
It's a surprisingly tender portrait of the man, actually, because he's got these big ears and these fleshy lips and these wide